I'm out here looking for food for the birds, and you're out chasing squirrels and birds and stuff. Hey, that good? That'll work. Apples that are falling off my tree. I could let them rot on the ground, but I prefer to feed them to the chickens. As much as I can, I try to give the birds natural foods. And it's not always easy, especially in the middle of the winter in Minnesota. What are you going to find out here that's natural besides snow? So in the fall, it's really a bonanza for them. I give them all the scraps out of the garden. I take apples and I stomp on them in the chicken coop, and they love pecking at these. That's kind of cool. And off to the garden. We got a few more things to get. Clover, grass, and miscellaneous weeds, especially dandelions. Whenever I can find dandelions out here, I yank those up because the chickens love dandelions. And I've been busted more than a few times by my neighbors. They see me out here like some kind of a crazy sheep pulling up grass out of my yard. And I know what they think. That crazy man is getting buckets of greens out of his yard. He probably eats them. They probably think I'm poor. But no, this is for the birds. This is for the chickens. And it's a natural thing. Since they can't be out here free ranging because they're not allowed, I come out here and I do it for them. Yep, I come out here and I grab handfuls and handfuls, all kinds of containers of these, along with the apples, fresh baked potatoes. I toss some potatoes in the microwave and bake them, and then I let them cool down. Scrap breads. I even have a little bit of baked beans in here from last night. Yeah, I feed them all kinds of stuff. But the cool thing about this is, as much as I can while the growing season is out here, I mean, come on, this is free stuff. I give my birds really good quality feed, and that way I get good quality eggs out of them. You get what you give. And so if you give your chickens nothing but corn, you're going to get low quality eggs with, I think, in my opinion, you're going to have a lot less nutritious eggs coming out of your birds, and your birds aren't going to be as happy or healthy. So as much as I can possibly do it, I'm out here every day, two times a day, like clockwork, rain or shine. It's been raining for the last few days. This is the first sunny day. I was out here in a hoodie, in the rain, pulling up grass, and it was cold too. My gosh, it was like 50 degrees. It was really, really cold. So I was out here pulling up dandelions, pulling up grass, feeding the birds, and I got to do that, because if I don't do it, who's going to do it? They're going to be sitting in there wondering where their food is, and that's not fair to the birds. I have a responsibility to them, and I take it serious. Even though I do enjoy my birds and stuff, I make sure that I feed them good. In the winter time, I don't have all this good green stuff. So what I do is I buy bagged feed, turkey feed, and I use that. I know it's not the best, and there are probably better ways to do it, but that's how I choose to do it. In the winter time, it's kind of like you just get through the winter, because Minnesota winters can be kind of tough. And when you're feeding your birds, you want to make sure that you give them something that has some good protein in it and some good calorie sources. So cracked corn is a staple in their diet, summer, fall, winter, spring, all the time. And then I add whatever I can to give them good stuff. Bugs whenever I can find them, greens all the time, and just miscellaneous scraps to keep them happy. And they also have these blocks of stuff that you can buy at the feed store. And they're like pecking blocks, and they just peck at them, and they got all kinds of seeds in them. And they love that. Keeps them busy. And if you keep your chickens busy, they're less likely to fight, and they're going to be less likely to be stressed out, and you have happier birds. That's how I feed my birds. Okay, let's head over and feed them, and then I'm going to show you a little bit of a surprise I got going on up in the voodoo garden for the Praxis channel. It's kind of hard to explain, but it does make sense when you see it. Okay, let's go feed the birds, and then Rascal. Rascal, come here. Hey, come here. I know what I'm doing is boring for you, but you got to stick around. He's out there sniffing around looking for stuff to, I don't know, kill. Not that he could kill it because he's so tiny, but he thinks he's a little bit tougher than he really is. Okay, I'm going to go feed this to the chickens, and then we're going to come back out, and I got to do one final harvest for the garden. Yes, I do have one final harvest to do, and I've been waiting to do that until today, and today is the day. I'm going to go feed the chickens. Hey, everybody. grass, clover, weeds, random crickets that get caught up in my harvesting. What are you guys doing over there? I feed them over there. They think all the good food's over there. Then I come over here and they come running over here. Then I come over here. Hey, look. Ooh. Baked potato. Yeah. You like that, don't you? Here, have an apple. Ooh. That one was mushy. Have another apple. Have another. I'm going to knock one of these poor birds out. Yeah, I didn't forget about you either, sweetheart. And that's good stuff, huh? Keeps you growing strong. Ooh. Whoa. Anybody that said chickens are nice, peaceful creatures hasn't met my chicken. Oh, that was good. The skin, best part. Ooh, baked beans with bread? It's a potluck at Ray's house. Hey. How about some tortilla chips? Ray, how's your organic chickens doing? Oh, you guys are a hoot. Hey, smell my potato. Yeah, you'd eat it if it had butter. My little vegan dog is eating my grass. Hey, more potato. Oh, whoop, more potato. Yeah, that's good stuff. It really is. You know, they seem kind of rough when they do this, but they're really not. I very rarely get my hand pecked. And usually when it happens, it's always by mistake. Hey, more potato? No. Can't be bothered? Hey, see? Good stuff. They can peck the littlest piece of green right off your hands like precision. Oh, they like baked beans. Yeah, that's good stuff. Homemade. Not organic, but yeah. I made some baked beans. Hey. Your beak is a mess. But nothing goes to waste. Almost absolutely nothing goes to waste. Rascal and Pepper, they eat scraps. The chickens, they eat the other scraps. Things that they don't eat go into the compost pile. Everything gets recycled around here, and I love the way that it works. Ooh, right in the face. Yeah. Anyway, let's go over to the garden, and let me do one last harvest, and then I'm going to take you upstairs. I'm going to show you the little surprises. Huh, what? Is this what you wanted? It's a bean. Yeah, you kind of like that. Well, isn't that something? I was coming over here to pick something else, and I looked down on this bed, and right over there and right here, these are cabbages. I harvested all my cabbage this year, and I pulled out all the other stuff, and I put a whole bunch of compost on here, and I was done for the season. I was done with this. And look at this. Little cabbages came up. Oh, how cute. Mmm. Crisp. Crisp and really tender leaves. Cabbage, by the way, any kind of cold crops, they love cool weather and they can survive frosts and everything. We haven't had a frost yet, but it's cold out here. Oh, I just drooled. Pardon me for enjoying my garden, but that's a nice little surprise. I did not expect that. This is really kind of cool. This is the Nardella pepper. You've seen it all throughout the season. And this is the last time we're going to show it. Yep, last time. This is harvest time. I planted this early in the spring around May, and I planted a second one. Second one died. And that was unfortunate. But this one really carried up the slack. And I planted a couple more over there, and they really didn't do that well. But this one, it grown in compost, did extremely well. And I got a first harvest, and I showed you that. And I also did a little tip. I said, when you get your first peppers, don't leave them on there too long. Harvest them off early in the spring. And that way, it can go through the heat of the summer without having to hold on to all those peppers and stress it out. Pick them off as soon as they get ripe in the mid-spring and so, or so. And then, sorry, I got a bunch of cauliflower in my mouth. It's hard to talk. But anyway, you let them go through the stress of summer, and then they will put out a second crop. And that's exactly what this did. As soon as the stress of summer was over, it put out tons of flowers. Not really tons, pounds of flowers. And then it put out peppers. And then it surprised me, and it put out even more flowers, and it's got little baby peppers. But unfortunately, my weather isn't going to hold out until these get full grown. But if I did have about another, I'd say three more weeks, yeah, I would have had a third crop, three crops out of one seed, and that's not really that bad. Come on in, and let's harvest this thing and get it I don't know, get it all done with. I know, it's kind of sad pulling up my last plant. That means that the last of the season is over. Holy cow, that's a fatty. Somebody grabbed the plant. Oh my gosh. These are the Nardellos. Yep, they're a beaut, and I don't have to worry about hurting the plant now because I'm not bringing the plant in for the winter. You can, by the way, bring these plants in. I showed how to bring in a tomato plant, and I think last year I showed how to bring in a pepper plant, but I'm not going to do it this year. I just don't need it. I have enough plants. Give me that. I have enough plants growing in the voodoo room so far, so I really don't need this. But otherwise, yeah, I would just pull it up, not be so nice, rinse it off really well, and then repot it, prune it back, and then let it start growing. Oh, wow. Kind of nice. And if I wanted to save, ooh, a little tiny one. I'm going to eat that one. Little bitty one. But if you want to save seeds from peppers, it's best to let them ripen because that gives the seeds the best chance. You know, if you've had peppers, I think that's it. Yeah, if you've had pepper seeds that didn't germinate, sometimes the reason can be that you don't have ripe enough peppers. And that's the key for me to saving seeds, is make sure those peppers ripen on the plant as much as possible. You can pick them and let them ripen, but it's best to let them ripen on the plant. And this is a Jimmy Nardello. Yeah, it does look a lot bigger than you see in the catalogs. And like I mentioned before, I believe that that's because they're just breeding bigger each year. You can see the classic crinkly part up here, but it is a Jimmy Nardello. I got some small ones, medium, and just, I call them great honkin' large. They're a beautiful pepper. Now, if you do want to save seeds from peppers, it's best to let them ripen before you take the seeds out. I've just never had good luck with taking seeds out of unripe peppers. And I tried to let these ripen on the plant, but it's getting so cold, I'm not going to be able to do that because my hands are getting really, really cold right now. Peppers don't ripen very well in cold temperatures. So these are just going to have to be for eating. So I'm going to take these inside, chop them up, throw them in the freezer, and have these for winter. I did take a couple of them that were ripe off of another plant, and I saved the seeds from those. So I do have seeds for the Nardellos for next year, so not to worry, I'll be growing a lot of those. But this is the final harvest from the garden and the final harvest from the Nardello. This is about the same size as the first harvest, so I got about twice this amount of peppers from one seed. Not bad for one seed, one pepper plant. Done extremely well. And by the way, no applause for growing this for me because I did it with the most simple method that anybody can do. Compost in your garden. There's no magic here, folks. There's no magic whatsoever. You just throw compost in your garden, keep your soil moist, keep the plants in sunlight, and you can have the results that I have. There's nothing special, so I don't do anything that you can't do. I'm just trying to teach you how to do things a common sense way and to do them the simplest way that I know how. And that's this. Candling eggs is so easy. You don't need to buy a special device to candle eggs. And they do sell special devices, these big wooden things or metal things that you put the egg on, turn on the light. And there are also ways to make a candler. All I do is I take a very bright LED flashlight. You can buy these for a few dollars at any hardware store. The ones that have the narrow end here are the best. Let me show you how I candle my eggs. Candling eggs is extremely easy, and it's actually kind of fun if you want to do this with your kids. Turn on the flashlight. I cup my hands around the flashlight to make a cushion for the egg, because you want to make sure that you're gentle with these eggs. There's a living being inside of these things. They're no longer a food source. We place the egg on top and put the light right up on it. And then we put our hands around it to kind of block the light from getting around so we don't blind ourselves. And if I put this up close, actually, let me get another one that's a better example. This one isn't as advanced. You want to candle your eggs about a week after you start them, and that'll tell you if they're growing. You'll just see a yolk in there if they're not, but if they are growing, you're going to see something inside darkening up, and you can see something slightly moving around in there. See that? That's the embryo starting to form. It's moving around all by itself Yep. You can't see it with my camera because it's really hard to film this, but there are blood vessels like a web in there, and that is the baby sending out blood vessels to take in nutrients, oxygen, and everything else. It's a beautiful thing to see. And these are eggs that are alive and doing extremely well. Oh, here's a good example. You put the light at the top and you can see all the way into there. Look at those blood vessels. Can you see those? And as the egg matures in the incubator each day, you're going to see less and less of these blood vessels, and this dark blob in here, which is the living, breathing baby as it forms, it'll start filling out more and more and more. And then you see this top part here, the light part? That's the air bubble at the top. And that is where the baby is first going to peck its way through and take its first breath of air when it's time to hatch. And then it'll start pecking all the way around here and then knock it off like a lid. Now, after about a week or so, I'd say 7 days, when you candle your eggs, here's one that isn't growing. This one just has the blob. That's the yolk. Every egg has a yolk. But you see, there's no blood vessels. No blood vessels whatsoever in this egg. This is an egg that's either infertile or for some natural reason just didn't catch. This one here has this ring up here. And generally what that means is the baby started to mature and then it died for some reason inside the shell. I give these 2 weeks because you never really quite know. I give them every benefit of the doubt. All right, now you want to do this relatively quickly when you candle your eggs. And I always put the ones that I'm not sure of over to the side and the ones that I'm sure of right in the middle where they get the best humidity and the best even heat. And you don't want to leave this open, by the way, very long. Maybe about, I don't know, 5 or 10 minutes while you candle, and then get the lid back on there because we don't want them to catch a chill. I know I'm a little overprotective, but that's just how I am. Okay, let's let them do what they do best and keep your fingers crossed. I'll do an update on this when it's about time for them to hatch. What are you looking at? Keeping the world safe from kitties? Huh? Did we have fun this year in the garden? Huh? Am I still your best buddy? Thank you. Thanks everybody for joining me in the garden this season. It was a blast. It was a total blast. This is my final season in this garden, and I gotta tell you, I had a really great time. I had a really wonderful time. But next year is going to be at the new house, and I'm going to be doing a whole new adventure. I'm going to enjoy it. Rascal's going to enjoy it, and I know you're going to enjoy it. Okay, I got to get going. My hands are really, really cold, and I hope you enjoyed this episode. I hope you enjoyed the new babies, and I will be showing them in future episodes. Ready to go inside? Okay, I'm going to go get the kitty. Where's the kitty? It could be anywhere, huh? What? Grr. That's a fly on your butt. Okay, we're out of here. Thanks everybody for joining us. Have a great day. Let's go.